let's say 2 years ago. Victor actually helped me start a program. Actually got motivated to do the program after
hitting colors. Bring that mic closer to you, man.
After hitting colors one. It motivated me to do the program. And I work in a Israel union, which is long for the Caucasians.
Yes.
So what it is that I went home and I did my homework about unions. And I knew unions were established to basically keep a black man from working.
Yes.
So since I got myself in the union, and I got all this Caucasian men who trusted me in a way, I decided to, you know what, I'm gonna start a program. But I'm just gonna go to high schools, talk to the youths, and try to get them to get the degrees that they need, the credentials that they need after high school, so that they will go through this employment, so that they can get themselves a job right after high school.
Right.
So that they don't get caught in the corners.
Quiet down.
Selling drugs and all sorts of stuff. But what I have noticed is, me talking to the kids is not helping. The parents also have to understand what they're getting their kids into. So what do I do as a person alone who is this to basically continue what I'm doing?
Talk to me. Talk to me. I'll help you
with that. And I think you have to formalize your program. And what I mean by that is you have to give it a curriculum that they can look at, a brochure, a website. You got to formalize. You also need to speak with the Department of Education in Toronto to see what you have to do in order for you to give out your own certifications to those children so they're then certified to work when they've done your program.
What it is this union has formed. They are 100 years old. I'm not trying to compete, but I do competition.
No, you don't have to compete with them.
I don't have
to. Just create a program just for our children.
But the union is willing to help. I have got a few complications, even though I do not trust them to the fullest. But I know when I tell them stuff, they want to help me. So
okay. Be careful they don't take over your program, because that's what they do.
Well, you can take over my program, but you can't take me because what moves me, they can't do it. They have basically have found that I've tried it, and they don't really have the power, the motivation to do what I do. So right now, they kind of start like programs at different high schools, which is workshops.
Okay.
And they send me to go do the talking to the kids.
I still think
I should.
You should get with the Department of Ed, find out what the protocol is for you to give out certs, because as you said, the job of the union is to stop blacks from working. You bringing black youth into a training program to become an electrician, that's a threat to the domination of the employment market. Sooner or later, it's going to become a conflict of interest. I'm not saying don't work with them, but I'm saying have a plan. You start seeing some things that you don't really appreciate, and you can do your own thing. I'm a big supporter of independence, and I think you need to have an independent program sanctioned by the Department of Education that allows you to train those young men and give them a cert. Going through that union gives the union ultimate control over what you're doing. You don't want to be colonized by them, you see. But I don't know enough about that to give a totally informed opinion. So see what the union is talking about. But I really don't see them being much help because you're trying to put more blacks in the electrician labor force and they're trying to eliminate it. I mean, it looks like an obvious conflict of interest to
you.
Careful about it, but I know that's not the way you're coming. There's a way that you can make every system natural in a year, in the world. And that is for black men to only date sisters who are natural. I only date natural women. I only date natural women. And I have to, because I'm before our young girls. And if our young girls see Dr. Umar with a process-headed woman, then that contradicts my message to them. So I cannot be with anything other than a nappy-headed black woman. And I would say this, it's not difficult to influence black women to go natural. I'm gonna tell you how I know this. There's certain cities I go to regularly. LA, Detroit, Chicago, Baltimore, New York. Just take them. In London, right? There's women in my audience who I've seen transform from the first time they heard me about a year or two ago to the present. I'm starting to see more sisters who were processed go natural. I didn't have to tell them to do it, but just by me speaking so powerfully, understand what I don't, and they automatically start to transform. I know at least 12 sisters right now in the States who I know went natural because I made them feel good about doing it. I reduced the anxiety with going natural, and when I see that they go natural, what's the first thing I do at the lecture? I go up to them, give them a big hug, give them a kiss on the cheek, and say, I love your hair. We got to reassure our women, because one of the reasons they're trying to look so European is because a lot of brothers only will date a woman who looks European. And that includes, and I've seen this in every ideological camp, from the Moors to the Nationalists to the Hebrews to the Rastas to the Socialists, everybody. I've seen brothers in every camp who will only deal with women if they look European in their hair. So us brothers have to deal with the contradiction of talking about the RBG, but we don't want to date a woman who's nappy. So the issue ain't really the system. Once we positively affirm natural hair, they will shake that other stuff off. But we got to be serious. Because a lot of us will ridicule a sister for not being natural, and then when you see our queen, she anything but natural. So you talking about me for not being nappy, but your queen not nappy. So I think the black man can lead the way to influencing our women to go natural. How we going, queen?
Yes, me and this me.
Go ahead, Cody, I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. And I want to thank you for coming to Toronto representing. It's beautiful to see it. I got a question for you.
Sure.
I spoke with an elder yesterday. I actually did my hair. And I asked her, you know, what is the difference between your generation and ours? She's Senegalese. And she said, our generation was grounded. There was no, it was very difficult to be influenced by different type of factors. And what I'm noticing, this generation, there's a lot on our shoulders, meaning that there's a lot of influence in left, right, center. If I look at something like academia, there's mass confusion. Where I look, there's posters about intersectionalities of oppression, race, gender, class, sexual orientation. So there's all these words, mass confusion that reinforce the mind to pretty much act in anti-blackness. That's my idea.
Yes.
So what I want to say is, what is your recommendation for this generation? What we have to do, what has to get done to minimize the confusion and more importantly reinforce an elevated African consciousness that will allow us to be in the position of nation building?
Excellent question. Very good question. The only way to change behavior is through institutions. The only way to change behavior is through institutions. I think the most effective thing we can do right now is build schools for our young people and raise them up with the mindset for liberation. Right now, we're losing because the people we are relying on to struggle with us don't have the mindset for liberation. Most of us have been damaged through white supremacy. We've been damaged through public schools. We've been damaged through propaganda. No matter how committed we think we are, we're not as committed as we need to be. And we have to raise the next generation to be the type of people we should have been. I think it all starts with education. We will not get out of this until we teach our children ourselves.